With the question, what is life, largely addressed at the molecular level, and with companies setting up labs to test how thousands of chemicals affect living things, and with new technologies like immortalized cell lines and somatic cell cloning, humanity could finally cure all disease and live forever. Except that didn't happen, because as usual, the natural world is a lot more complicated than humans first thought. Today, we will be telling the story of the Human Genome Project. It's really cool, you guys. Epistemically, the amount of information contained within even the smallest organism is simply mind-boggling. There is lots and lots of DNA. Molecular biologists had figured out some genetic sequences in bacteria and the viruses that hijack them, but mapping the human genome? That seemed like mapping every star in the universe. Technologically, scientists in the 1950s and 60s could barely sequence DNA and RNA at all. One major breakthrough came in 1977, when British biochemist and double Nobel Prize winner Frederick Sanger developed a new, reliable way of decoding DNA that became known as Sanger sequencing. Sanger's method became the standard way to sequence DNA until the late 1990s, when next-gen high-throughput sequencers became available. It's complicated, but Sanger sequencing cleverly works by chopping up an unknown sequence of DNA, tagging them with four different fluorescent dyes that bond to the four different nucleic bases, and then sorting out the segments by length. You can repeat the process many times to decode an entire genome. One of the main issues is that decoding one sequence of DNA requires lots of copies of that sequence, and copying DNA, up until the 1980s, took lots of time. Like, weeks to months, and it was expensive, and even then it didn't always work. Enter American biochemist and avid surfer Carrie Mullis. In 1983, while working at the biotech firm Cetus in California, Mullis developed polymerase chain reaction, or PCR. This was an automated way of taking advantage of a natural process for copying DNA. In PCR, cycles of heating and cooling alternate between melting DNA and copying it using enzymes. PCR can make billions of copies every hour, helping scientists quickly replicate strands of DNA for study. Mullis and his bosses published a paper on PCR in 1985, and he went on to win the Nobel Prize. Now, you could say Mullis didn't fit the mold of a traditional Nobelist. For one, he admitted to using LSD frequently in his youth. And for a really weird two, in 1998, Mullis wrote an autobiography denying AIDS is a thing, which is just, like, really? It's like denying pigeons. Anyway, luckily modern science doesn't rely on individuals. It's a team sport, and the teams keep getting bigger. By the late 1980s, some biologists began to discuss what had seemed impossible a decade before, completely decoding the human genome. The stated idea was to understand the different versions of genes that seem linked to cancers in order to develop better cancer-fighting drugs. Another goal was political. This would be the Manhattan Project of biology. The US would fund the future of medicine and attract the top biologists. Hopefully no bombs, though. Planning began in 1988 when the US National Institutes of Health, or NIH, and the Department of Energy agreed to work together. And the federal government created the office, later the Center for Human Genome Research. The center's first director was the famous James Watson, but he resigned early on, and the physician and geneticist Francis S. Collins took over. Collins, by the way, has a rock band called The Directors. The Human Genome Project officially began on October 1st, 1990, with the goal of sequencing a representative working draft of 90% of a human genome, a model blueprint for a human body. There wasn't, like, a central hub. Instead, many labs participated all over the world, so planning the project took years. But in 1996, DNA sequencing for the draft genome finally began at six US universities. Thought bubble, Primus. Humans are complicated, so many geneticists began by sequencing related organisms. In 1996, an international team finished a draft sequence of Saccharomyces cerevisiae, the yeast humans use to make beer, bread, and biotechnologies. Although Saccharomyces is a microbe, it was still the first eukaryotic organism with a membrane-bound nucleus, like humans, to have its genome sequenced. Also in 1996, scientists revealed a map of 16,000 human genes. Critics thought the Human Genome Project would be a gargantuan waste of money, but the project was moving much faster than predicted. In 1997, the center became the National Human Genome Research Institute, or the NHGRI. And then, in 1998, American biotechnologist J. Craig Venter entered the competition. Earlier, Venter had worked at NIH, where he became an expert in making short synthetic bits of DNA called expressed sequence tags, or ESTs. These were useful for identifying genes, and Venter and the NIH controversially tried to patent them. The US Patent and Trademark Office said no in 1992, but this battle introduced Venter to the scientific limelight. So later, when Venter disagreed with the manner in which the Human Genome Project was being managed, he decided to compete with it privately. That's right, one dude said, "I'll beat the entire United States government at science." Venter believed that the HGP should switch from reliable but slow Sanger sequencing to a much faster but more expensive new method called shotgun sequencing. Sanger sequencing only works on DNA up to 10,000 base pairs, which is very small. Shotgunning a genome involves fragmenting it into bits several times in a row, and then letting a computer try to piece the blueprint back together. Each pass is flawed, but collectively, they add up to a whole sequence. Thanks, Thought Bubble. Venter wasn't shy about letting the other HGP leaders know he thought they were doing their job wrong. He officially quit the HGP and started a for-profit company, Celera Genomics, that planned to use shotgunning and automation to sequence the human genome in 3 years, 7 years faster than the HGP. He would pay for this by holding the sequenced genes as intellectual property. That is, he'd continue his decade-long fight over whether or not human genes can be owned. This rush to make money from human genes paralleled the pre-HGP rush to patent cell lines like the University of California's ownership of Mo from last episode. And other companies followed suit. In 1998, the government of Iceland controversially licensed the health data of all 275,000 Icelanders to a private US Icelandic company called Decode Genetics, who were looking for genes linked to illnesses. Decode declared bankruptcy in 2009 and has since been acquired by different companies. In early 1999, sequencing of the human genome at a large scale began about a decade after the project started. This was slow compared to the rapid development of the atomic bomb, but arguably, that's like comparing one dangerous apple to like billions and billions of oranges. And the Human Genome Project had effects even before it finished. In 2000, President Clinton signed an executive order to prevent genetic discrimination in federal workplaces. That same year, both a public group and Celera released the genetic sequence of the fruit fly, one of biology's rockstar model organisms. And then, also in 2000, with Venter about to scoop them, the leaders at the National Human Genome Research Institute called a truce. President Clinton, British Prime Minister Tony Blair, Venter, and Collins announced collectively the completion of 85% of a draft human genome. Collins and Clinton both invoked religion. In Collins's words, "We have caught the first glimpses of our instruction book previously known only to God." The complete draft was finished in 2003, and everybody was a winner. Private industry had fought the government to a stalemate and secured serious investment. The government had spent less than $3 billion, which, if you think about it, really isn't that much for a moonshot. And medical researchers, evolutionary biologists, and bioengineers now had more data than they knew what to do with. Within 13 years, hundreds of scientists around the world had mapped the roughly 3 billion base pairs of DNA that code for a single human body. But they understood very little of it. Originally, they predicted there would be about 100,000 genes, or regions that code for proteins in a human genome, but there were only 20,000 to 25,000. In fact, most DNA doesn't code for anything. Some DNA serves important regulatory functions, turning coding genes on and off. Some may be junk. So in 2003, NHGRI launched ENCODE, the Encyclopedia of DNA Elements Project, in order to understand all functional elements in human DNA. ENCODE published results in 2012. On the technology side, the race to map the human genome drove the price of sequencing DNA DNA way down. Sequencing cost continues to fall exponentially. The first human genome cost $3 billion. Today, sequencing one human genome costs about $1,000. Lots of companies are doing just that. There are over 1,500 biotech companies in the US today, and more than 10,000 labs that conduct genetic sequencing. And since 2009, community biology labs have supported the rise of DIY bio, a movement wherein amateurs can sequence DNA and practice bioengineering in nonprofit labs. So what has all this DNA discovery led to? Immortality? Flying cats? I don't want flying cats. Sadly, human genetics remain really, really complicated today. Medical researchers are still working out ways to reprogram certain genes to, say, not give rise to cancer, or to reprogram immune cells to fight cancer better without the need for toxic drugs. One day, healthcare might be specifically tailored to your unique genome, and we'll talk about this vision for personalized medicine in two episodes. What the Human Genome Project and cheap genome sequencing did in the 1990s and 2000s, however, was change criminal law and not change popular understandings of race. At first, defense lawyers were suspicious of DNA evidence. What if the lab made an error and sent the wrong person to jail? But they soon realized that DNA evidence could be used to exonerate the wrongfully convicted. Today, DNA is a cornerstone of forensics. It's seen as more reliable than fingerprint evidence. Of course, some people find it super creepy that authorities can profile someone using their DNA. Outside of the courtroom, the Human Genome Diversity Project, or HGDP, was organized at Stanford in the 1990s. Its mission? To collect DNA samples from thousands of different populations to understand human diversity. Its founder, Luca Cavalli-Sforza, was a prominent geneticist who thought HGDP would fight racism and celebrate different cultures. Yet some critics accused HGDP of being racist by exploiting indigenous people for potential commercial gain. The World Council of Indigenous Peoples called it the Vampire Project. Ouch. Recently, genetic ancestry testing has become commonplace. These tests could have highlighted how incredibly similar all humans are, and how artificial groupings based on so-called races are. They are the products of imperial census-taking, not science, but instead, many ancestry tests reinforce census race terms. According to pioneering historian of biology Evelyn Fox Keller, the 20th century was the century of the gene. The concept was born, explored, and finally understood to be much more complex than anyone had first thought. Genes aren't necessarily the best or even very good ways of thinking about traits in the blueprints of organisms. DNA isn't a computer language, it's a kind of molecule. And knowing more about it may lead to better and better medicine, but it's gonna be a long process. Next time, we're headed back to the world of data. It's time for the birth of everyone's absolute favoriteest place, the internet. Crash Course History of Science is filmed in the Dr. Cheryl C. Kinney studio in Missoula, Montana, and it's made with the help of all of these nice people, and our animation team is Thought Cafe. Crash Course is a Complexly production. If you want to keep imagining the world complexly with us, check out some of our other channels like Sexplanations, Healthcare Triage, and Mental Floss. If you'd like to keep Crash Course free for everyone forever, you can support the series at Patreon, a crowdfunding platform that allows you to support the content you love.